I'm Adam Maness.
And I'm Peter Martin.
And you're listening to the You'll Hear It podcast.
Jazz Explained.
Jazz Explained. It's our tagline. Jazz Explained.
You know what? It's not just a tagline.
It's a way of life.
It's a lifestyle.
I mean, you could sum it up best, actually, by saying something like...
just play the right note!
Just play the right notes.
We could. You know? We could. But I think that, yeah, Jazz Explained, Jazz Discussed, Jazz...
I'll play it and tell you what it is later.
Exactly. Yeah. Now, does anything speak to the jazz lifestyle any more than that quote from Miles Davis?
No, I'll play it and tell you what it is.
Yeah, it's so great. Yeah. So great.
Now, there are a lot of people who might be listening who might be thinking, you know...
I'm not a fan of jazz.
Why would they be here?
Why would you be listening to this podcast or watching this podcast? Shout out to our YouTube channel. If you haven't gone
YouTube.
And subscribed to the new You'll Hear It YouTube channel, we're putting every...
I'm looking at you.
We're putting every episode. Peter, do you know this? We're putting every single episode up onto YouTube.
That's a lot
of... Isn't that crazy?
That's a lot of commitment.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
But go check it out. You know, we...
Let's just say, just to... For further fodder for our listeners, our podcast listener. Fodder.
Further fodder.
Hi, Luke, you are my fodder.
Sounds like a cover band playing at the bar down the street.
Wait, I'm going to add it to my list of great band names. We're going to talk about that. I got a good list, by the way. Avocado is in a lot of them for some reason.
This is Marty Daly's thing. You know our friend Marty Daly? This is what he does.
Friend
he
of
keeps
the pod.
A list. Yeah.
Absolutely. I've got my own list. But no, fodder for the listeners. You know what fodder is? F-O-D-D-E-R.
Is it droppings? What is it?
No. Why?
Fodder? Is
what
it,
is he saying?
Is it, what is the definition of fodder, actually?
Give fodder to, well, it is not what I thought it is. I will take that back. It is food, especially dried hay or feed for cattle. Or other lives. I thought it was like fodder, like
I am your fodder.
Well, I made that joke 30 seconds ago, but no, I thought it was this is fodder for the other people, like things to talk about.
Well, I think maybe that's
gossip.
It, like some nuggets of food, food for
food
thought.
For thought.
Thank
fodder,
you, Caleb.
Fodder for thought. Oh, here we go. Fodder is not just used to describe cattle feed. We use the word to talk about other kinds of feeding that don't involve actual food.
Good podcasting.
A new celebrity marriage is fodder for gossip magazines. That's what I meant. Okay, I'm not crazy. What's happening? Fodder. So anyway, back to my point. Fodder for our listeners is that go to the YouTube.
Okay.
That's good.
Oh, wow. This is bad.
You're right. Forget it. No more fodder. Just go to the YouTube channel. But we're having fun over the YouTube because you can leave comments.
We do
there.
Have fun.
You can leave comments. So even if you're listening on the pod, take a little time when you get out of your car or whatever, when you can safely do it. Go to the YouTube and drop us a comment because we love to hear what you guys say.
Well, also drop us a comment. Drop us a rating and review wherever you're listening to this podcast. I'm talking about Apple Podcasts. I'm talking about End of List because that's the only one I really know about.
Spotify.
Spotify?
Ever
can
heard
you
of
leave,
it?
Leave a rating and review
Absolutely.
On Spotify?
Right.
No kidding.
Yeah, please do it.
Did not know that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, we are excited. We're coming up on 1,000 episodes. To be honest, we might have already hit it. How would we know? Because we lose count. But I think, no, we're not quite there yet. But 1,000 episodes of the pods. Congrats in advance, Adam.
Are you already patting me on the back for something that hasn't happened
Well,
yet?
In case you don't make it, congrats.
Okay. Yeah.
You could say the same to me, see?
I'll try my best. So we've got, speaking of another thing you can do, we're giving out like tasks for our listener to do.
Tasks.
So you could go to youllhearit.com and you could leave us a voice message on our speak pipe. Speak into the pipe.
And leave a question. But you know what? If this is your first time listening, you're probably already turned it off by now because we're telling you to do too many different things.
There's a lot going on.
You can also just relax and listen to the pod.
Just relax.
Or just pick one of these things.
Yeah, listen
we're
to
excited.
The pod.
Sue us.
But Birch, he went to youllhearit.com and left us this voice message.
All right.
Hey guys, Birch here, longtime listener, longtime speak piper. I would really enjoy hearing you guys break down the sound and style of Ahmad Jamal. He's one of my favorite musicians. He was the very first jazz concert. I was visiting New York back in the 90s, didn't know much about the music, and I saw him at the Radium, and it just blew my mind. So I really feel like he's a unique style that's evolved a lot over the years. And as a bass player, I just love his arrangements because they leave so much room for the bass to play melodically. And he used to do a little trick where the bass would be playing in two, and I noticed he would lay his arm on the piano when he wanted the bass to start walking in four, and it was super effective. Anyways, hope you guys are doing well. Thank you.
Amazing. So that's like a visual cue that Birch is talking about there.
Yeah.
That Ahmad.
Which
does.
Is a big part of when we talk about breaking down his style, his arranging is always, you know, kind of integral to the discussion of the Ahmad Jamal sound. You know, his orchestration, both of the piano, but more so of the piano trio.
I think it's the biggest part of his playing.
Yeah.
I think it informs everything else. I think he is one of the most unique jazz pianists in history.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
One of them, if not, I mean, possibly the most influential, especially when you talk about beyond just pianists.
Yep.
And especially with the Miles Davis, you know, Miles Davis was just infatuated with his sound and his style and the way that, you know, his architectural approach to spontaneous arrangement. And so this is like the visual cues that he would make, which are not that common in jazz. I mean, we're always signaling little things, but I mean, like with the number system, with the bass, he has a very sophisticated approach to that. And so it's, you know, I think that you can't talk about, that's a great place to start talking about it, I would say.
So let's start then at that great place. This is from But Not For Me, Live at the Pershing. This is But Not For Me. Let's listen to a little bit of this classic. If you know any Ahmad Jamal, you probably know this.
And what year is this?
58.
Right, sorry. Okay, can we pause it? So this is like, this is when you really have greatness. Talk about breaking things down. When the details are so lined up, aligned within the trio, but so relaxed. And it's great because I was asking about the date because I've got another example after we listen to this that's also from a different club in 58.
Nice.
So this was very much like a trio that could play in concert halls, outdoor festivals.
Totally.
Ahmad, it's always been like, I've seen him in many different situations and clubs, but I think when we talk about this classic period and this sound, you know, with the audience there, it's even more exciting to hear that energy there and to hear the precision with which they're playing. But it's that combination of like precision technically, individually, and then together the way they play.
Absolutely.
But also just a super relaxed vibe. But if you hear the way that Ahmad comes in and then the way Vernell Fournier and Israel Crosby both come in at different times, but it's like, it's almost like watching a graph with boom, 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 and then it's just, they're just all there beautifully. Let's check it out again. Ah. I mean, it's just perfect.
Iconic at this point.
Yeah. That bass line. You know, very, Ahmad's very detail oriented. Like, well, behind the beat, J Dilla right there. What about that? Repetition, space, slight adjustments, micro adjustments.
Call and response.
Yeah. Oh, syncopation, voicing, dynamics. You know, laying back on the beat while others are right on the beat. This is way behind the beat. You know, the nuances of the different registers. Because you've got here, the piano up here, the drums kind of in the middle, the bass on bottom. And all this single line stuff, and now this.
Themes.
First block chords, right?
It's just all little compositions within the composition.
Yeah. Oh man, every time I hear this, it's like I hear something new.
Vernell there.
And that accent with the sizzles.
You know what you don't hear a lot in this entire record and in Ahmad's career is very few solos that are based around burning eighth note lines.
No.
It's all thematic.
No.
It's all these melodies.
But on this record, he goes in there in little places.
Little places.
Which makes it even more effective.
Well, it's all very well placed.
Yeah.
And then when he does it, it's like, oh my.
I know.
You know?
Yeah. It's a lot of just restraint.
Yeah.
And then, like, at times, really going for it in a way that really heightens it even more in terms of the arrangement. Oh, that's nice. It's like theme and variation.
So much of this.
Oh, and then Ahmad doesn't play that one with him. Sometimes he, I mean, like, those choices of when to play and when not to play, nobody did it better.
Melody? We just heard Emmett Cohen quote that on our millennial show.
Right. That's right. That's like a little bit of, you know, little flurries there. Huh. And if you check, I mean, you could just do it. Ah.
Dynamics here. Big chords played very softly.
It's such a cool place to go to that in the arrangement. Oh, and the way this ends.
Is there anything better than that? That's so good, man. What a great.
So I think the
perfect track.
Perfect. I think the two biggest manifestations of Ahmad's influence, I mean, he's so influential, but there's two in particular, I think, about Shirley Horn and Miles Davis that really took his concepts and, like, you could just hear them, especially the kind of more nuanced ones in a great way. I wanted to play just a little bit. Did we answer the question? I can't remember the question.
We were answering right now,
man. Oh, good. What makes Ahmad Jamal so great? That was pretty much it, right?
Well, no, it's
oh, break it down.
Is he the most unique jazz pianist in history? But it's really just an offering to break it down.
Right.
And for me, the takeaway here is, like, everything is a theme. There's no line playing. There's no running your fingers.
Yeah.
Everything is very precise.
Yep.
You know, everything is a statement upon your expectations as a listener. It's pretty awesome, man. Especially if you consider when this was, in 1958, when everybody's, you know, doing that kind of thing around him, right? That hard bop is ruling. And you can see
he's
then,
got those elements there.
Absolutely.
It's not like it's not like he's going left.
No, but Miles's band at this time
is
doing that kind of stuff. And then after this record, it's not.
Yeah, exactly. You know, well, that's what I'm saying. That's where you hear that, and I agree, the precision. And by precision, I think what we mean is not that he's playing right exactly in the time, because he does know how to lay back and then, but precision in terms of, like, his intentionality of when he's going to be right in the groove and then when he's going to pull it back and then when he goes back. Like, he had such an innate awareness of how that affects the architecture of the tune, how that affects the arrangement. And he was just this brilliant arranger and a brilliant pianist, kind of all combined together. And I think that's what really, you know, Miles took from it. Shirley Horn a lot. I mean, Shirley Horn took a lot of just, like, voicings and different things and approaches to playing trio that I think are great. Can I play one track? We don't have to listen to the whole thing. I just wanted. I was thinking about this intro and how it sort of typifies Ahmad's style to arranging these standard tunes. This is Old Devil Moon, which, I mean, to me has never been my favorite tune. Am I allowed to say that?
You're allowed to say
whatever. I'm 52 years old.
It's your
now.
Show, man.
It is not my show. It is our show.
We can say whatever we want.
It's a fine tune. It's just it's not bad, not great or whatever, but this just shows how you can take something and set it up in a way where then you're open to greatness. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I love this intro. So simple, but just like the last one on the But Not For Me, but in a different way. I mean, of course, Point Siena. You know, it's always like, Ahmad was a master of, like, one great idea for the arrangement and then letting the greatness flow from that. Oops, I abused my friend. Should we try that again?
Give it a shot.
Should we give it a shot? Let's give it a floor run, see how she plays.
Yeah, you know, kick the tires.
Yeah.
Oh, this is great. Yeah. What is this from again?
This is from Live at the Spotlight. That's same thing, 1958.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. Like,
the space there is so incredible. Can we do that, though? Can you do a high single melodic line without you just feeling like you're ripping off Ahmad Jamal?
No, but that's okay.
Yeah.
But this is the thing. What comes before that is what sets it up. You know what I mean? Like, a lot of people will take this and just, like, start right there. Or they'll be like, oh, that intro's easy and corny. No, it's not.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, and listen to him tapping his feet. For the four. And I mean, that's just genius the way Vernell Fournier. So it's like, because this is like an offset, it's a very simple syncopated rhythm, but it starts on the and of one, and you don't really have a reference point unless you can hear him kind of with his foot, which you probably wouldn't be able to if you're in the audience. So Vernell Fournier lets it be, instead of being like, you know, like set up, he lets it be for a whole measure and then resets it immediately, which is kind of, you know, just a fun little thing. Ooh! And then he comes in with the bass drum along with it. And then he pulls back. Everybody pulls back. Come on. one thing that Israel Crosby's doing, right? What is he not doing?
Oh, anything else. Let it breathe, man. Let it breathe.
You know what I mean? It's just like, which is...
This might be the best version of this song.
A little unison. Oh, in between the walk and bass line.
Has there ever been a better kick drum bass player combination? The kick drum and bass and of Israel Crosby and Vernell Fournier are always so locked in, and they have, I don't know if it's the tuning of the drum or what he uses, but they've dialed that in, man.
I think it's the tuning, because there's a lot of potential for overlap in a bad way, because
for like things to swirl around too much.
Because Vernell's using that bass drum like a New Orleans drummer.
You gotta ask Hutch about this. He would know.
Oh, for sure. For sure. But he's using it like a New Orleans drummer for accents, for syncopations, for fours and stuff. And Israel Crosby is sparse in a way, but then once he starts walking and then rejoining the melody and stuff, there's a lot of chance. I think they're just so tuned, you know, Vernell's got that bass drum tuned so well. It's right there, but it's not on top of it. Let's listen to just a little more. Unison bass.
So good.
Woo! I think Herbie got this from Ahmad. Now, this is something that you hear Ahmad do, especially later on, like getting into the 80s, 70s, 80s, 90s, all his great performances, but he was already doing it then, is this idea of like getting a riff and departing from the melody. Miles definitely got this, well, I'm assuming he got it from Ahmad, because that's one of the people he admitted to stealing stuff and being influenced by, but where you can just get up, like what happened to the melody? You know what I mean? It's like drifting off to this cool little area, like you're on the side path and then you're gonna rejoin it. He just skipped over that whole part of it. He already played it. He's Ahmad Jamal, you don't need to play it again.
Can I play something a little bit later? This is from 1998. This is Ahmad Jamal with the Asai Quartet. Have you ever heard this record? Listen to this is Comp Time. He's in his 60s at this point. Artie Dixon on drums. E from Wolfert on bass. You know, this is like Ahmad Jamal with a string quartet. You know, like, if my wheelhouse had a wheelhouse.
Yeah. No, it's such a... I love this period of Ahmad, too. We're always going back to the classic, but this is...
No, yeah, there's another
record. You can really
record.
Hear it. He's stretching out.
The very first time I ever saw him live was in 1998?
Yeah.
You got one?
No, I'm saying pull it down a little bit so they can hear you talking.
1998, and it was with this album. Do you know this whole series, The Essence? Listen to that. So this is Devils in My Den from Nature, The Essence Part 3. This is also 98. He was so productive.
Like, yeah.
At this, in the 90s specifically.
Absolutely. I saw him live a bunch of times.
Making amazing music. playful.
I mean, from the 90s to the 2000s to the aughts or whatever they
call it. He's still with us. He's 92. Still with us,
yeah. I mean, he retired, and then I heard he's like, oh, I've decided I'm not totally retired.
He's like, I'm still, yeah. I can still play, so let's do it.
But I mean, he was such a, he has been a fantastic like headliner on jazz festivals around the world because he's Ahmad Jamal.
Yep.
But also because he's just known to have, like, he's super professional. Like, he brings, you know, even as he's gotten older, he brings his A game. In fact, he cancels if he doesn't have his A game for whatever reason. Like, he's just known as that. So promoters and concert impresarios love to have him. Like, they know they can count on him to be Ahmad Jamal, which is not always the case with all of us, you know. But I'll just throw a quick story out before we leave the Ahmad Jamal episode, as we must. We don't want to, but Ahmad's music is here, and Ahmad is still here. No, but the first time I met him was in Italy in the mid-90s. And we were coming from this festival, and like we were waiting on the ride to take us back. And I'd actually just heard Ahmad play. He kind of played last on the same stage we had played earlier, and I was so excited. But then we're like waiting for the ride, and finally they got like this van, but it was like really tight, and the driver, and you know, we were all kind of like drugged. And I got in the van and was like, oh man, this is, and we got to get up at 3 a.m. to travel. I get in the van and kind of go into the back. Who's sitting in the back of the van over at the corner? Ahmad Jamal. And I was like, wow, okay, what? He's driving with us. They're just like driving us all back, you know, late at night. And so I was like, well, I'm going to go sit next to Mr. Jamal. And I went over and introduced myself. And, but I was also realized I was like complaining about the van. And then all of a sudden he's just sitting there relaxed, peaceful, chill. A legend. That's what made me realize. I was like, I ain't got nothing to complain with. But I sat next to him and we ended up talking. I didn't want to push it. I just sort of talked a little bit and, you know, he had actually heard us play and was like really complimentary. And we just had a great discussion about piano and him. And he was just, he was exactly like he sounds on the music. It wasn't like one of these things where he's just like, get away from me, little dude, or whatever.
He's a great guru if you're going to have a guru.
He was like, so just cool and, you know.
I have a little shrine in my on my piano. To like one of my most prized possessions is a Jimmy Katz original print of Ahmad, you know, like sunglasses on, black and white. You know, that Jimmy Katz look.
Yeah,
so beautiful.
Yeah, yeah.
I love it so much, man.
Awesome.
Stays on my piano. Let's go out with something from 2017.
Okay.
So this would have been when he was 85, a young whippersnapper at 85.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
So this is Marseille featuring Abdel Mali. You know this?
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
From the album Marseille from 2017.
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Jamal.
What's up, YouTube?
Oh, okay. I didn't know if you were canceling our YouTube people.
I know it's something you would like to do.
I would not. Hey, you didn't hear. He's wrong. I didn't say that. He said that.
Oh, boy.
No, thank you guys for sticking around.
We have fun.
We're having fun on the channel. Let us know in the comments below your favorite Ahmad Jamal.
So many good ones, man. What a
album,
career.
The or 70s, track, the or period.
I like that. We ignored the whole 70s. But
you look angry
really,
about that.
I am angry.
You are a child of the 70s.
It would take a full week's worth of, maybe we do an Ahmad Jamal week. I'm just saying.
Well, I'm getting this idea about, that I just floated out there. It's safe to tell these folks about doing a YouTube video. What makes Ahmad Jamal so great?
That'd be great.
How would that be?
That'd be great.
You know, and just kind of break down sort of what we were just saying. But I mean, it's just so interesting, his approach to not just playing the piano, but to the whole thing. Anyway, thank you guys.
Cheers.
Peace.